thank you very much, Saskia. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Does anybody have a light, maybe? No, I'm not going to smoke here, obviously. But this used to be very normal, not so long ago. Here you go. Last year, my grandfather died, and my parents asked me if I'd wanted something out of his belongings. And I immediately knew this wooden carved cigarette box. And when I smell that box, it takes me immediately back to my childhood, to his home, and to the parties he would throw, where that same box would be on the table, filled with Caballero without filter. You know, the manly cigarettes, you know, right? And everybody would be taking cigarettes out of that box, and they'd be smoking. And as a child, I would see the room be filled with a blue misty haze. You remember this, right? Yeah. My kids would call this nuts, literally. We quit smoking. You don't want to inhale somebody else's cigarette smoke anymore. But we don't seem to be aware of the fact that we smoke these poisonous fumes all of the time. From our cars, when we cook, when we shower, when we heat up our homes. So just the other month, research done by our National Institute for Public Health indicated that each and every one of us, not only you, also your children, we passively smoke the equivalent of 5 cigarettes a day. 5 cigarettes a day. Your little baby being born starts smoking 5 cigarettes a day, passively. We are trapped in what I consider a perverse energy system that forces us not only to suffocate ourselves, but also to poison others. And I get mad about that. Maybe I should tell you a little bit about my background. I come from a family of not too tall, somewhat sturdy, hard-headed farmers, you might have seen. And our family parties, well, they, to an outsider, they would look like little war zones. To an outsider, we'll be fighting, but we were enjoying ourselves, just having discussions. So it's in my genes, and my parents there in the room, they can confirm this, that I don't like to be told by somebody else what to do, let alone a big energy company forcing his or her perverse system upon me. And I'd expect other people to become warlike too, like me, also wanted to start a revolution. But what I experience quite often is that people, they try to convince me otherwise. When I talk to them about clean energy, they say, yeah, clean energy, that's not that necessary, or clean energy is not that clean. I have 2 electric cars, and I'm very enthusiastic about them. And many people say to me, yeah, but you only bought those cars for the tax benefits. Electric cars aren't that clean. So I get annoyed, and I also get a little bit mean. So I tell them, electric cars aren't clean, right? Let's do a little experiment. We take 2 garages, and you put your gas car in yours, and I'll put my electric in mine. And then you put your kids in your garage, and I put my kids in mine. And we close the door, real airtight, start our engines, and leave them running for a couple hours. It's a horrible sight, right? I'm not in a position to blame other people about being cynical on green energy. I used to have big cars with big engines, V6 engines. And I love the smell of diesel. And Mark Lanfala says, the smell of dust and diesel. I used to be not aware about the fact that I was smoking all these poisonous fumes. But that all changed overnight. November 2013. I'm sitting in the back of a car, And I'm driving through the subtropical city of Shenzhen. It's near Hong Kong, in the south of China. It's a crazy place. It grew from 20,000 to 14 million people in only 30 years. I look out the window, and all I see is gray, depressing industrial zones, big housing blocks, dusty coal plants with big black plumes coming out of them, electrical wires running all over the place. And what I don't see is the sun. I've been here for a week, and I have never once seen the sun. It's always covered behind these thick layers of smog. And I'm in shock. This is what it looks like when a government puts short-term economic growth over the well-being of people. And this is not just a Chinese problem. All your stuff in your cupboards that said made in China, they're made with this energy. And there in the back of that car, I decide what my social footprint is going to be. I'm going to devote the rest of my life on ending fossil fuels. Coal, oil, gas, our fossils, they gave us great wealth. But we can now have all of that, but without the downside. We have beautiful techniques to get energy from the sun, and from the wind, and from the tides. We can even get energy from the core of the earth. We have production processes that require less and less energy. And we are connected, not only via the internet, we are able to organize ourselves, but we're also connected via an energy grid that is growing every day. We can now get solar energy from Germany and hydro energy from Norway. I think it's a very exhilarating idea. You and I, we can build the energy company of the future. The new Royal Dutch Shell. And it's not going to be like the Royal Dutch Shell we know. Maybe you heard last week that the CEO of Shell said, yeah, but we still have to use fossil fuels for the decades to come. No, we're not going to use that. We're going to choose for renewables. We are going to change the biggest infrastructure mankind has ever built, the energy infrastructure. Our Shell is going to be green. You might think, changing the biggest infrastructure mankind has ever built. That sounds like a complicated task. Well, let me tell you, it is. And you might think, how can I be of any help of that? But you are all essential for this project. Because you are the ones that have to stop paying for fossil fuels. You have to start investing in green energy, renewable energy. Get green energy at home. Replace your gas boiler with an electrical heat pump. It's going to cost a lot, this transition, I have to be honest. But I think society has to pay for the people that cannot afford it. The good news is, this transition, we will only pay with euros. We'll be no longer paying with our health, or our lives, or our planet. We have to stop investing in fossils. It's crazy. It's like we're trying to perfect a system that in the core will always be imperfect. And secondly, you are the front runners, the early adapters. Sustainable solutions, they're not perfect yet. So they need some developing. And that might take you some effort as well. You might have to look up some information on the internet. You might have to clean up your attic to have your solar panels installed. And that sounds like a small price to pay, but let me tell you, for a lot of people, that's a real big hiccup. For many sustainable projects, that's the Achilles heel. And third of all, we need a change in perspective. Cars, for example. You were led to believe that cars represent ultimate freedom. You have to be able to drive anywhere you want, anytime you want it. You know these commercials, right? A happy family driving somewhere, an exotic coast or in the mountains. But when was the last time you came down in the morning, walked up to the breakfast table and said to your family, I have an idea. Let's go to Spain. Nobody, right? That never happens. Electric cars will take you where you need to go on a daily basis and even on a holiday. I took mine to Italy last summer. No hassle. We have to realize that we are the ones. We are the generation that can give our kids a clean, everlasting energy system. And my wish for you today is that when you leave this room tonight, you will never be able to see another exhaust pipe again without thinking, I have to smoke those poisonous fumes. That will get inside your head. But it will also trigger action. I know we can do this. We were also able to see that Marlboro Man isn't cool because he's smoking. No, we figured out that he's a tough cowboy, but he needs to change his nasty habits. Thank you very much.